My name is Michael Moreland. I teach in the law school at Villanova University outside of Philadelphia. It's my honor to introduce this afternoon's speaker, John Finnis. John Finnis is professor of law and legal philosophy at the University of Oxford and Beal Keeney professor of law here at the University of Notre Dame. He has published widely in law, legal theory, moral and political philosophy, moral theology, and political and religious thought of William Shakespeare and the history of the late Elizabethan era. Among his many books are the 1980 classic Natural Law and Natural Rights, Fundamentals of Ethics, Moral Absolutes, Tradition, Revision, and Truth, and Aquinas, Moral, Political, and Legal Theory. A five-volume edition of the collected essays of John Finnis was published by Oxford University Press in 1981. As I was thinking the past few days about giving this introduction, it occurred to me that one of the characteristics of Professor Finnis's long career has been his remarkable courage. Courage in single-handedly rehabilitating natural law theory and contemporary jurisprudence, courage in plumbing the depths of difficult topics in moral and political theory, courage in articulating positions often at odds with the prevailing academic culture. On account of that courage and insights that have followed, I suspect people will still be reading John Finnis in 100 years. We have the good fortune of hearing from him right now. Professor Finnis.
Thank you, Michael. I think I'll have the nerve to say that my collected essays are published in 2011, so you get 30 years extra over and above 1981. So that's the last of my commercial breaks. I'm very privileged to be here and grateful for the opportunity. I entitled my thoughts, "Dare We Talk About Body and Soul?" By a revolution in scientific understanding and information in the early to mid-20th century, inanimate materials and processes, the non-biological, though partly organic realm of chemical elements composed of molecules, atoms, and the subatomic realities describable to some extent as particles and to some extent as waves, all came to be understood as essentially activity according to pattern or dynamic structure. It is a revolution that has not been taken sufficiently into account by anyone who thinks of the world as constituted by tiny particles of matter and their movements. The concept of matter cannot be eliminated, but whatever it stands for, which is surprisingly hard to grasp and describe, let alone account for, is entirely dominated by the patterns of activity, which in many kinds of case remain more or less stable, articulable by the same or same sequences of mathematical formulae, while the matter or material within or at the place of the patterned activities or active patterns comes and goes. And that coming and going leaves undisturbed the identity of the being that exists, say, was under observation, direct or indirect, not long ago, whether as moving or at rest, and is under observation now, and will be for a while yet. Such domination of matter by dynamic pattern is found no less pervasively and even more strikingly when we move to the fields of biochemistry and biology, revolutionized in the mid to late 20th century by advances in scientific understanding that show no sign of slackening off. I'm going to sketch some aspects of this domination by recalling some well-known facts. Let me say from the outset, though, that the metaphor of domination must, throughout, be heard with some specificity or adaptation. It's not at all a question of domination from the outside, as one person or group or nation dominates others, but of something as inward as could possibly be, and entirely free from negativity. It's rather the gift, so to speak, of rendering the barely potential into something actual, with three spatial dimensions and some duration, the gift of bodiliness. of being as body by virtue of this dynamic pattern. Pattern that, as we shall see, has some other appropriate names. Incidentally, this bodiliness of the pattern, that is, as an intrinsic resultant of the pattern, means that as Baconian, Galilean, and all subsequent science triumphantly confirmed, the way to discover and understand the dynamic patterns is through, by inference or induction from, the quantitative, measurable, sense or machine observable. One set of facts that I want to recall has to do with the language, that is, the concepts in which this rather new scientific understanding, biophysical, biochemical, or biological, is universally articulated. The cells and organisms that make up the realm of life, of living beings, are understood and described, their subsisting and activities are understood and described, as directed at the micro level by a series of intra and intermolecular realities, activities, relationships, and patterns most adequately describable in terms of information, messages and messengers, expressions, programs, sense and nonsense, transcription, reading, translation, copying, and so forth, as aspects of the working of a code with four or five letters, the four nucleotide bases in DNA and the slightly different set of four bases in RNA, without which DNA cannot perform its essential functions. Of course, all these terms, information, code, program, messengers, and so forth, terms pervasive in all these life sciences, are being used by analogy with their focal or central case usage in relation to our activities as intelligent beings communicating with other intelligent beings by intentional acts of meaning. So I shall call the information spoken of in these modern natural sciences analogous information, as distinct from the central case kind of information conveyed by, for example, what scientists tell themselves and others. The structure of the analogy shifts somewhat, we should notice, as one moves from biological sciences to so-called information technology. For in the latter, the primary issue is transmission and loss or degradation in transmission. The quality and significance of the input is beside the point. But quality of input matters greatly to the survival and flourishing of biological realities, rather as in the case of central case information, which we distinguish sharply from disinformation, lies, errors, not to mention muddles and nonsense, even when disinformation is transmitted as readily and accurately as is objective information, information stricto sensu. Among the empirical realities that persuade scientists of the need to use this analogy, this language, these concepts, is the capacity of organisms to repair themselves when damaged and to work around and respond ingeniously and even proactively to lesions, insults, diseases, and threats to their immunity in ways impossible to machines, however complex, of the pre-information technology era, and imitated only partially and still somewhat clumsily by the IT machines of today. That capacity, along with the organism's capacity we call metabolism or nutrition, to ingest and transform external materials into its own organism, and the capacity to reproduce itself by replication without loss to itself, together mark the great advance that the living makes over the non-biological. And each of these capacities is a potent aspect of the domination of matter by information. Indeed, to use Aristotle's language, by form, in the strong central sense in which the term refers to substantial form, which is rather the very act, that is, actuality and process, of a body. Your body, like mine, comprises some 60 to 100 million, that is 100 trillion cells. Each of the cells in your body includes within it a genome, actually or practically unique to that body, a genome that includes, along with thousands of millions of other components, 3,000 million pairs of bases from the four kinds of DNA base. That is to say, these billions of pairs are arranged within each cell in your body and in mine in a way partly unique to each of us, but common to all the other cells in the same body, thus enabling your coherent growth and organic functioning and mine as the specifically human but very, very individual person you and I each are. But a genome, like a molecule or an atom or an electron, is to be thought of as essentially an ongoing activity focused by its pattern, or in a dynamic sense, its structure. Each of the billions of weak hydrogen bonds helping constitute the strands in a single DNA molecule is broken and replaced perhaps scores of billions of times per second without that molecule losing its reality as a bearer of specific information. Nor is this sufficient stability of patterned process subverted, let alone dominated, by the subjection of each of its parts to the molecular storm, as it's commonly called, the fact that every millisecond an average molecule undergoes 10,000 million collisions at jet plane speed with water molecules, each comprising three atoms. A cell exists, therefore, as a maelstrom of molecular activity in which the component molecules and their components, each set unimaginably numerous, are being amended and replaced in a constant stream while retaining their lasting, subsisting identity by virtue of the more or less constant pattern or structure, the information which unconsciously the cell knows how to read and apply in its activity. And the same goes at the level of the organism. It is an essential, if not defining, characteristic of the living being that by virtue of its subsisting dynamic pattern or form or structuring information, it subsists even while all its material elements are replaced. So every day of one's life, about 500,000 million cells in your makeup and mine are destroyed and replaced by others functioning to substantially the same pattern. Not one of these cells can any laboratory or network of laboratories engineer, yet one's makeup, dominated as it is by its information, both species-specifically human and peculiarly individual, knows how to do it. The analogous knowledge in play here is that without which the analogous information would not be information. These and many other facts, remarkable facts it seems to me, are expounded in the books of those scientists who have got to know about, track, report, and partially account for this analogous information. For them, when they discover it, and for us, when they report it, it has become central case information. One such report, out of hundreds and thousands, is the well-praised mainstream 2012 book, Life's Ratchet, by Peter M. Hoffman. He's a biophysicist, focused therefore on exploring the physical underpinnings of living systems and the use of physical methods to explore life, who after his Johns Hopkins doctorate did his postdoc work in nanophysics at Oxford around 2000, and now co-runs both a nanophysics laboratory and a biomedical physics program at Wayne State University in Michigan. Like most people, he believes, the book reveals, all sorts of old fables, such as that the Gospel of John is steeped in Platonic philosophy, and that Christianity relegated the material world to a corrupted reflection of the spiritual world. And explicitly following the lead of the old atheist atomists like Democritus, he tries from time to time to assign everything recounted in his book to either chance or necessity, and sometimes even to chance and necessity at once, in either case without remainder. But against that attempted top-down summary of what the science he expounds discloses about the world, there stands the title of his book, Life's Ratchet, and its subtitle, How Molecular Machines Extract Order from Chaos. And equally, there stands almost everything in the book's scientific substance. You can open it at random and find statements such as these. Stability in DNA is also actively achieved by repair enzymes. If for some reason a part of the DNA molecule becomes corrupted, the repair enzymes will fix the mistake, using an adjacent section of the molecule that is undamaged as a chemical template to repair the corrupted part. Unquote. So besides chance or randomness, which is pervasive but massively dominated by order, there is not so much necessity, but rather what I have been pointing to, which he articulates in his own summary of the subject of his science, life is matter and program. And if we are looking, as we reasonably can, for a better top-down summary of what the science he expounds discloses about the world, for a reflective and explanatory summary, not a research methodology, we can find it wrapped up in his talk of ratchets and other biophysical machines and of repairs achieved by enzymes and so on and so forth, the special intelligibility of design. This pervasive reality about natural reality, this fact of pervasive, though far from randomness-free, design, he takes for granted when he is doing and expounding his science, but dismisses when he is doing reflective, top-down, philosophically explanatory, or would-be explanatory, summarizing. He dismisses intelligent design for two interrelated reasons, it seems. He confuses intelligent design with the idea of vital forces, a 17th and 18th century scientific quasi-animism intended as a research program or hypothesis for investigation by a search for the force within the order of nature, natural causalities, and natural events. An inappropriate research hypothesis, even in the realm of living beings, that is, of the non-inanimate. And Professor Hoffman falls the more easily into this confusion because he knows nothing of the fundamental difference between causalities within nature, the entire natural universe, what theologians and philosophers have often called secondary causes, and on the other hand, transcendent, creative, and/or providential causality. That is a distinction about which Hebrew prophetic and wisdom teaching and then Christian philosophy and doctrine got far clearer than Plato or even Aristotle ever did, for whom the divinities were, in the last analysis, within nature. Perhaps the quickest way towards grasping the distinction, or at least its significance, is to recall Thomas Aquinas's critique of a certain scholarly Muslim idea of creation and providence, the doctrine of the Mutakalimun, who held that the divine designer's transcendent power works its effects by divine decision, moment by moment, and independently of natural causalities, which are thus more apparent than real or worthy of investigation. St. Thomas's response to this is a reply also to those who imagine that the designer rationally envisaged by Jews, Christians, and by Charles Darwin in a notable page in his mature diary, initiated everything merely by one tremendous initial creation of natural potentialities, which since then have been merely left to their own operations and the independent working out of their initial potentialities. No, says Aquinas to both sides, what we think of as effects of natural causes are indeed that, effects of natural causes in chains or sequences of causation which can fruitfully be investigated by natural sciences. And at the same time, all these natural effects and causes are being caused here and now, as much as at the beginning of time, by the power of the intelligent designer. They are effects wholly of their natural causes and wholly of the transcendent beyond nature cause that explains both the creation of nature from nothing and all the workings of nature ever since. By reflecting on this wholly, on the thing or event in question being not partly attributable to nature and partly to divine power, but rather in whole to natural causes and in whole to God, we can get close to the true meaning of the word transcendent. The thesis secured and secures the place and integrity of the natural sciences. It leaves us free to work simply and without reservation with the methods and hard investigative labor found fruitful in the natural sciences as they are practiced today. Leaving altogether behind us the idea of explaining or accounting for natural phenomena by the vital forces against which Hoffman protests, we can nonetheless observe, like Hoffman, that the difference between the living and the non-living is vast, so great that he even speaks more than once of there being no conceptual connection. Life, to recall what he says, is matter and program. But now we can add a new point. Program that programs dynamically patterns the resilient homeostatic self-stabilization and self-reparativeness, movement as a whole from within, of living beings, and that programs also their responsiveness to stimuli, their self-assembling growth and metabolic capacities, and their reproductivity and signaling capacities, such functioning program, brought to light in biophysics, biochemistry, and biology, just is what Aristotle called soul, psyche, anima. The animation in an animated, not inanimate, reality being. To call programs of this kind soul, insofar as they are actually in place in or as informing and constituting individual beings, is not to appeal to vital forces as an explanatory principle, nor is it to propose either a new research methodology or, for that matter, an old one. It is rather to sum up the inherent efficacy, substantial effect, and mode of reality of molecular and cellular and organic processes of molecules, cells, and organisms, just as they are disclosed to be, both in these sciences and in the experience or observation of bodily life. Speaking of soul in this science-led but and not science-leading way enables us to say a few things about body and soul in animals, leaving aside just for the moment the human animal, or treating the human animal in abstraction for the moment from any factor that could differentiate it from other kinds of animal. One thing to say is that the animal lives not as a body with a soul, nor as a soul in or with a body, but as body and equally as soul. Since the animal's bodily life, its bodiliness, is its ensouledness, as Aquinas says. Or to put it another way, the animal's soul is that in virtue of which the animal has its bodiliness, its corporality. As program dominating by directing matter, and as the very activity and actuality of the body so actualized, soul dominates, but is altogether in service of body in the unitary being, the organism, the animal. We can apply here what the Second Vatican Council says about a different kind of animal, our kind, that it is corpore et anima unus, translatable only with some circumlocution. This being is one thing, as or by virtue of body, and as or by virtue of soul. Soul, program, dynamic pattern, information as directively operative in, with, and on particular, that is this or that matter, Soul is wholly present in and constitutive of every part of the body. The same soul, one and the same soul, and giving the whole body its solidity, its tautness and softness, its surfaces and its flexibility, strength and vulnerability. In this understanding of reality, there is no Cartesian-type problem of identifying the junction of mind and body or of the ghost in the machine. And the animal's death is not accurately called the separation of soul and body. Rather, it is the termination, cessation of both soul and program, and therefore body, leaving merely a corpse, which is describable as a body only loosely by a kind of equivocation or a focus on the relationship to the past. It is rather a heap of bodies of chemical, organic, at least for the most part, but not biochemical, compounds, even these decomposing towards the inorganic. Peter Hoffman's willingness to say that there is no conceptual connection, his phrase not mine, between the most fundamental levels of matter and energy and entities so highly complex and mysteriously self-moving as a living cell or organism, no easy matter for a nano or any other kind of physicist to say and accept, is significant in more than one way. For one thing, it points in the general direction of the thought, explored notably by various French Catholic philosophers such as Claude Tremonton, that the information in the universe has been increasing, and indeed is increasing, indeed at an accelerating rate. That thought, in turn, points to the further thesis that transcendent causality's creative activity was not exhausted, so to speak, its creative activity was not exhausted at the initial creation, to be simply replaced by providential governance, but rather has continued continually, even if not continuously. That is a thought that, once again in the nature of transcendent causality, leaves the field of scientific research for intranatural causes entirely unaffected. And the sheer or discontinuous newness of the information does not eliminate, but rather deploys, the pre-existing levels of information-constituted reality, just as the information-constituted water molecule deploys the information constituting its three atoms by directing the removal of the hydrogen atom's electrons to the oxygen atom, leaving the residual hydrogen ions positively charged and the oxygen atom negatively charged, which is the basis then for that formation of hydrogen bonds between neighboring water molecules that is fundamental to the emergence of giant molecules and thus via long chains of information-directed causality to the emergence of cellular life. For another thing, discontinuity of the kind identified and accepted by biophysicists such as Hoffman provides good background for an inquiry into the life, the ensouledness of us human beings or persons. That is, for the question whether within the general field of highly complex and self-moving living beings, there are discontinuities of type as real and relevant as the discontinuity between physics at or of the nano level and biology at the level of cells and organisms. Any such discontinuity would, of course, suggest an occasion for some transcendent act of creation of information new in type, even if by no means as simply new as what first emerged by creation ex nihilo. Now, it is indeed obvious that such discontinuity does indeed obtain within the range of animal life, and in a manner far more profoundly discontinuous than the discontinuity between the living and the inanimate. For among animals, there are all the countless kinds, each member of which can deploy information, dynamic pattern, and animal soul, but only in dealing with the here and now of its own material makeup and the makeup or sensed movement of other bodily realities that impinge upon it, whether directly or by the less direct but still material causalities that we call the senses and animal responsiveness to such stimuli, responsiveness which as in, say, sheepdogs, may be wonderfully subtle and supple. And there is one kind of animal that can do all that in some measure, and also can consider information as such, search it out, consider it for its accuracy, doubt the truth of claims or other intimations that it exists, and subject it to tests of verification and falsification on the conscious hypothesis that if it is confirmed here and now, it will hold true, at least in all like circumstances, wherever and whenever. In that last sentence, I took the case where one's thoughts are considering the material world, but already in its universality, abstracting from the here and now. And that case already displays the spirituality of thought, its independence in strong and specifiable senses from the material, notwithstanding its evident dependence on material preconditions pertaining to one's brain states, neural efficiency, and freedom from sensory overload, and many sorts of bodily malfunctioning. The relevant independence is especially the impossibility of correlating any brain states or other material preconditions with the correctness of the thought, with the validity or invalidity of the reasoning, and with either the warrantedness or unwarrantedness and or incorrectness of the provisional or final concluding judgments, positive, negative, or unproven, undecided, that one makes. And thoughts are deeply concerned with their own correctness, validity, warrantedness, truth. So thought also considers matters far removed from the material, such as the logic of if and but, and so, therefore, and despite, even. So too it concerns ambiguity and double entendre, or the kinds of causality, or conditions of fairness or unfairness in actions or omissions, or the question whether one's vocation is to be an animal psychologist dosing up neurotic rats or to be a London cabbie. And in either case, whether it is overridingly desirable that one seek the friendship of and some humble likeness to any transcendent creator. Thought both sets up and is unmistakably aware of the reality as well as the phenomena of free choices, such as we each make from time to time, between beneficial alternatives, or apparently beneficial alternatives, such that nothing within or beyond one settles which option one prefers and adopts. Nothing save the choosing itself, a freedom and consequent responsibility that one exercises willy-nilly even in choosing to argue that it is a myth or illusion. It is ineluctably clear that all these objects of thought, that is, of the human activity of thinking, differ radically from brain states and from other physiological and physical preconditions for our thinking, and differs so radically that we need terms to mark the difference in kind of activity. Immaterial and spiritual are the terms available. Philosophers, the great majority of our contemporary philosophers, are quite correct to say that the proposition there are some free choices, in the sense that, say, Aquinas asserts, which is also the common sense today as then, that proposition, there are some free choices, is a proposition incompatible with important propositions that atheists typically hold about the closed system of nature conceived as the empire exclusively of chance and necessity. In saying that the souls of this kind of animal are spiritual, immaterial souls, we are putting to good use the highly reliable epistemological axiom that to understand X's nature, you need to understand X's capacities. But to understand a capacity, you need to understand the acts or activities or actualizations by X of that capacity. And to understand those activities or acts, you have to understand their objects, where the acts are headed, or on what they're focused. Human beings are beings of a nature such that they have the capacity to perform spiritual operations on spiritual objects, which you do in the most ordinary and entirely unspooky ways, such as by the thoughts I mentioned in some homely examples a minute ago, and by choosing to tell jokes or to withhold them, deciding to do sums and choosing to persist until you judge they're correct, reasoning about the implied permissions and prohibitions with which your mother left the cookies in the fridge, wondering whether nature is self-explanatory or the product of a transcendent act or acts of mind and freedom, and whether, and if so, how to address that mind and will, that personal transcendent being, in prayer and so forth. These are spiritual, or as Aquinas rather prefers to say, rational acts and operations of wondering and reasoning that end, and indeed often begin, in judgments about and decisions between open, eligible alternatives. This sort of capacity transcends, exceeds greatly and in kind, simply biological capacities, capacities that are only material or corporeal, even animate and sensitive and as subtly sensitive and freewheeling as a sheepdog's. It is reasonable to infer and judge that the information needed to empower animals of our kind or nature to engage in the spiritual activities we do, the activities of a person, must be information over and above that which is transmitted by the animal body-soul operations we call generation. And so we reach the thought that Aquinas argues for philosophically, carefully reviewing all conceivable alternative explanations. I will articulate the thought in terms of the biology of generation that we now know with clarity and certainty, but was unknown to Aquinas. You can see our biology of reproduction laid out conveniently in chapter 2 of Robert George and Christopher Tollefson's book Embryo, though they refrained, for good reasons, from articulating and exploring the thought I'm about to articulate. Leaving aside the occasional instances of monstrous growths incapable of developing towards human activities, hydatidiform moles and teratomas, we should conclude that the product of the union of male and female gametes, the conceptus, has the distinctively human form that it has, the information, program, system, dynamic pattern, soul, and activity it has, by virtue of an initiating act of divine creative power, such that it is a new thing. For this new being's soul, as capacitating it radically for rational, spiritual, personal, and freely choosing acts, is not the resultant or product of the biological makeup of either gamete, or in any other way, of either parent, any more than those spiritual acts, when he or she engages in them, will be products or resultants of his or her biology, or brain states, or parents. Rather, this new person's soul, which from the start will also be the form of his or her body, the source of its being his or her body, is de novo, something new, and as Aquinas starkly says, ex nihilo. An elegant theological formulation of this position we find in the Catechism of the Catholic Church, paragraph 365. The unity of soul and body is so profound that one has to consider the soul to be the form of the body, i.e., it is because of its spiritual soul that the body makes, that the body made of matter becomes a living human body, spirit and matter, in man. Not two natures united, but rather their union forms a single nature. 366, the Church teaches that every spiritual soul is created immediately by God, is not produced by the parents. And then in brief, 382, man is corpore et anima unus, body and soul but truly one. The doctrine of the faith affirms that the spiritual and immortal soul is created immediately by God. Now, this conclusion of reason and revelation was in a way harder for Aquinas to reach than for us. He did not know about the historical fact of evolution, of the sequential emergence over billions of years of new species of being, notably of living beings and of species after species of them. Even granting the neo-Darwinian hypothesis of a single common ancestry of all species, it is clear that species are real, with massive stability outstripping in lasting significance all the extinctions along the way. This history of evolution manifests, as I have said, a vast progressive increase in the amount and kinds of information existent in the universe and active as the forms of beings. The belief that all this information was already present somehow at the time of the Big Bang and its immediate aftermath, with nothing around but hydrogen and a bit of helium, seems like mere supposition, even a superstition. The hypothesis that the divine creative activity needed to explain and, in one sense or another, initiate the universe has been an activity not reserved to one individual moment, but rather has continued through the history of evolution, overlaying the law of increasing entropy with the countervailing empirical reality of increasing complexity and vivacity of beings. This hypothesis is one that we can sum up as creation has continued, particularly the creation of new species. But Aquinas thought the book of Genesis confirms that no new species have been created since the initial creation. So the thesis that creation continues day by day in the creating of new human souls, his thesis, and thus new human beings, had for him more than for us the character of a sheer exception. Of course, no one will forget that for us, the surrounding culture has grown forgetful of the truth that the universe is the result of creation, of a free divine act, dependent on nothing, on no materials, ex nihilo. Or forget that this culture is increasingly contemptuous of what it imagines that thesis to be. So in some respects, the full Catholic doctrine of creation, involving, as we see, the ongoing as well as the original, is more challenging for us than for Aquinas. Not that he was in the least unaware of atheism and of countless other denials or evasions of the fact of creation. Pope Paul VI, soon after the conclusion of the council in December 1965, became deeply dismayed at the condition of the church, at the interior apostasy, as he called it, the widespread repudiation by liberal Catholics of basic church teachings, including teachings plainly reaffirmed only a year or two earlier by the Second Vatican Council, a repudiation, especially amongst biblical scholars, that has continued wide and deep to this day. So at the end of the Year of Faith, he had called to commemorate the 1900th anniversary of the martyrdom of Saints Peter and Paul, believed to have occurred in the great and historically well-verified Neronian persecution of Christians after the Great Fire of Rome in AD 64, Paul VI proclaimed in June 1968 the Credo of the People of God. Its very first article reads, "We believe in one only God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, creator of things visible, such as this world in which our transient life passes, of things invisible, such as the pure spirits, which are also called angels, and creator in each man of his spiritual and immortal soul." Now, quite generally, we understand God's being and activity more by what it is not than as what it is, about which we understand only that it is what is needed, whatever it takes, to explain the reality that things within our experience are what they are. So we must not try to imagine or model the causality whereby God creates each of us. For that, of course, is what is meant by saying that God creates ex nihilo, one's spiritual soul. That soul is the one form, spiritual or intellectual, and sensitive and organic, vegetative, that makes matter be one's body. That is, one's own single unitary bodily and spiritual reality. All we know about that instance of divine causality is that it is whatever it takes to make what begins to emerge in the union of maternal and paternal gametes be what it is. The astounding union of bodily and spiritual in an individual who then and there, as a result, has what it takes to grow up wholly the child of these parents and someone who can choose to tell a lie or, like Thomas More before his judges, to refuse to tell a lie. I called that union astounding, and so it is, but it is not a miracle, a departure from or deflection of the order of nature. And so too, Aquinas denies that the creation of the rational soul involves a miracle, even though, as he says, it adds to everything that the ordinary operations of nature, particularly we should now add the chromosomal and other structures of the maternal and paternal gametes, quite naturally do towards bringing into being the human conceptus. We can be confident that the creation of the rational soul takes place within the inwardness, so to speak, of what is already soul, of what is already the dynamic impress of intelligent design, of the dynamic patterning information, substantial form that I have been trying to give some sketch of, as what dominates the existing of all living beings more potently and flexibly than even the dominating role in the atom and its particles, the dominating role there of information or system. The coming to be of the new person at conception is wholly the outcome of, to take the natural case, the parents' bodily actions and omissions and the natural bodily outcomes of those, and equally is wholly the outcome of the immediate particular divine action by virtue of which, in this new case, just as in the coming to be of each of these parents and of the first human persons, this conceptus is human, and thus, as this human being is, in his or her radical capacities, a being from the outset of a rational, which is also to say spiritual, nature. One manifestation of that nature will naturally be, as I've been stressing, free choices, and one's free will's capacity, once it is an actual, not merely radical capacity, to exercise an inward mastery over many material elements in one's makeup, a mastery too astounding, as I remarked a few minutes ago, to be acceptable to most secular philosophers today, although its reality is apparent in every argument they choose to offer, whichever version, compatibilist or incompatibilist, they choose to insist upon. This capacity displayed in mastery is no more than the summit in this world of what we see at every level of created being. Every level, subatomic, atomic, molecular, viral or cellular, organism, animal, human, manifests integrally the dominance of form over matter. That dominance is, in the last analysis, as I've tried to sketch, the dominance also, indirectly or directly, of mind. At the lower levels, simply of the creative designer's mind, manifested in the information which shapes or constitutes the systems of dynamic pattern that are all we can specify about subatomic or molecular existence. And at the highest creative level, created level, within our observation, the dominance also of the mind that you make manifest to yourself and others by directing attention to some significant difference between one thing and another, by simply pointing with a finger, or choosing to utter, say, by typing, an intelligible word. And so the supreme natural, this worldly manifestation of mind is that exercising of freedom in choosing by which rational, if not reasonable, creatures like us exercise, whether they like it or not, their mastery, dominion, domination over their own acts by making and carrying out free choices, including, often enough, choices to deploy natural realities at every level of being and reality. Contemporary secular philosophers, I will mention them again, usually are willy-nilly at an utter impasse, denying any real freedom of choice by reason of their materialist naturalism, while exalting autonomy and repeating, but making no sense of, the thought insisted upon by Aquinas before Kant, that each of us is an end in himself or herself. In Aquinas, that thought is not an expression of arbitrary self-preference, but a truth about one's true nature as a human being, one's true dignity in the eyes of oneself, others, and equally of the creator and sustainer. So what, finally and briefly, are the dangers that suggested to me the title, Should We Dare to Speak of Body and Soul? Here are a few, very few. The first and most obvious, as I've been arguing, is that the phrase body and soul may suggest the false belief that body can exist without soul. At neither end of life and nowhere along the way can one speak of anyone's body, or indeed any animal's body, as if it could exist without its own soul, the very soul that makes it be not only this body, but also this body rather than this decomposing heap of matter, to be treated in the human case with the humanity due to its past as such and such a person. The modern widespread double-think version or cousin of this is the thought that the person comes to be sometime well after conception, quite possibly after or well after birth, and fades out into extinction in conditions of coma or senility, leaving the living body he or she once inhabited a tangle of confusions, appealing to imagination and sentiment, and laying the groundwork for lots of homicide, if not now, then to come. But even our own homely language, reproduced in the Catechism, of soul separating from body can mislead. For the separation does not leave the body behind, but rather that corpse becoming dust, so that death is not so much a separating as a rending and very thoroughgoing dismantling. The second danger is that the linked pair of nouns, body and soul, may suggest that the soul might somehow pre-exist the body, as Platonists and Neoplatonists and Pythagoreans and Origen and Plotinus and many Gnostics, Manichaeans, Cathars and their successors have believed, not least those who imagine that the soul is transmitted somehow from the father and mother to the child. A heretical imagination, says St. Thomas. The influence of these dualisms has been so great that I think there is some danger in using the phrase that Pope John Paul II did occasionally, and some other Orthodox Christians concerned to combat materialism do use likewise, embodied spirit or incarnate spirit. Better, I think, to stick to rational animal and then do some work to bring into full view the spiritual character of reason's operations, as I've tried to do very briefly along the way. The heresy, as Aquinas put it, about parental transmission of soul is blocked and excluded by the doctrine that points to the rational soul's true origin in a divine creative act at the time of conception, bringing this person and then that person into being. In a fundamental sense, ex nihilo, though inseparably along with the body that this newly created soul constitutes, not ex nihilo, as body. As this bodily zygote or embryo, this person distinct from that person. The danger here is that the teaching may be misunderstood as guaranteeing the immortality of persons. But the teaching's greatest exponent, though in no sense its originator, Thomas Aquinas, says and repeats that my soul is not me, anima mea non est ego, and that, I quote, if my soul is saved, still I am not saved, unquote, but only a remnant of me, unless there is a resurrection which is my resurrection, body and soul, the resurrection of the dead, as our oldest creed puts it. Such a resurrection would be a miracle of the first rank. And the only resurrection about which we have any information whatever is that of which Jesus Christ's, revelation informs us. A revelation confirmed by signs and wonders, miracles testified to by eyewitnesses who, as the Second Vatican Council most emphatically and precisely teaches, in our four Gospels are writing for us from their own memory and recollection, or whose testimony is there directly recounted. Revelation telling of a resurrected human life, which in its bodiliness is also spiritual in a new and body-transforming way. But immortality, and for that matter the great theme of Revelation, the faith as objective central case information from the same source as the natural analogous information that has been my theme this afternoon, those are for another day. For today, enough perhaps to have recalled, partly through big numbers, how much less separated from each other are realities as truly distinct as nature and miracle, mind and matter, soul, even spiritual soul, and body. Thank you, Mike. Well, it's roughly the way I put it, and I don't think I want to try and say very much more about it. Talking about it runs into two difficulties. One is the distinction between creative causality and natural causality, and the other is the difficulty of explaining even how a word, like the one I just uttered then, the word word, is both material and spiritual, how it bears meaning. It's just a material thing, some waves and some electric in your ears and my tongue and so forth. And it conveys meaning, and it can be true or false, and we're thinking about its truth or falsity or the proposition made up of such words and so on. And that's so mysterious. So what all one can do is circle around these realities and get them into place, but looking for something that we can, as it were, imagine. We can't even imagine how meaning and words are connected. We've no imagination, we've no picture of that. And yet it is the most humdrum reality and nothing like as exciting as the coming into being of a new being. Yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Finnis. Jim Kushner from Touchstone Journal. You mentioned at death that we have a heap of decaying matter. And I'm just wondering what you would say of the relics of the saints, the incorruptible, in some cases incorruptible.
Yeah. Well, saints. we say it's a miracle, and so there's a preservation of. I did say matter, but I also said a heap of bodies. So it's not truly matter in some strong sense of matter. It's bodies, and then in the bodies of most of us, it's descending rapidly towards dust through various organic changes. In the corpses of those miraculously preserved from corruption, it it's the body that it is, and that's all we can say about it. That it's this body, that it was the body of that saint while living, and it's been preserved by a miraculous intervention in nature. I don't know that we can say more, or need to say more. Yeah.
Thank you, Professor. Michael Hannon. I was wondering if you could comment on this. It occurred to me while you were speaking. What I'm about to say, sorry.
Okay.
As you were distinguishing humans and our rational capacities from other animals, from other beings, and trying to show the kind of radical difference between man, the spiritual rational animal, and the rest of animality, not to say the rest of creation entirely, it occurred to me that this is an interesting move because, thinking back to the famous debate between Anscombe and C.S. Lewis at Oxford, it's precisely this distinction between reasons and causes, as it were, that leads Anscombe to attack and deny the soundness of C.S. Lewis's famous argument for miracles against naturalism. But this very distinction between reasons and causes seems to be leading you to at least a similar conclusion, if via somewhat different means. Is that fair to say that Anscombe's correction of Lewis actually yields the same result?
Or is it something actually what?
Yields the same result as Lewis's original argument, do you think?
That Anscombe's, it gilds the same whistle? Or?
Oh, I'm sorry. That it yields
the same
result, conclusion.
Result, yeah. Uh-huh. No, I wasn't talking about reasons and causes. There's the precise point at which Anscombe criticized, and it seems successfully, Lewis on miracles, we'd have to identify, and then we'd have to ask whether that point was one that relates to the point that I was making, and that you were recalling, I guess, between the activities of reason and the substratum of biological, biophysical, neurological, brain state, electrical, etc. activities that sustain those. Now, I strongly doubt in talking like that, which is the way that Anscombe herself was very willing to talk, corresponds to the way that Lewis was talking that led to her critique.
Thank you.
I'm David Calhoun from Gonzaga University. Thank you, Professor Finnis. In your remarks on Darwin, you asserted that species are real, and you commented that they persist across all the changes in nature. A central argument of Darwin's origin is the claim that forms, that natural kinds or species are arbitrary and nominal. And I wonder, were you implicitly rejecting Darwin's claim by making that comment that species persist across time?
The species of what?
Persist across time.
Does Darwin deny that species persist across time?
No, he does. I was wondering, are you...
Does he really deny it? I mean, he may say philosophical words like it's nominal, but does he think that species don't last for 5 minutes? Does he think that, not say something
right.
philosophical about it? Look what the theory offers to assert. Don't look at Darwin's comments about it. Although I did refer to a comment that Darwin makes about the whole picture late in his life, after he's famously, as far as he did, vindicate his account, that this is inconceivable without a divine mind designing it. And then he peels away from that thought, but only under the influence of the argument from evil. I can't reconcile these two thoughts. And then in the end, he finishes up in a condition of agnosticism. But pursuing what he says is a rational reflection, he comes to the judgment that this is design. Now, when thinking like that, and as I say, when thinking just scientifically, he's thinking on both occasions about species as no doubt having fuzzy edges, et cetera, but something worth talking about. And it's only when in this sort of intermediate category of philosophizing that he'll say things like they're not real and so forth.
Okay, thank you.
Philip Sloan from University of Notre Dame here. Professor Finnis, first of all, I want to congratulate you. I thought there was a marvelous discussion of numerous complex points, but I want to urge a caution about one issue, and maybe you can make a comment on this. This is what I would call replacing what is old-time gene essentialism with the essentialism of codes and information. I think the studies that have been done, for instance, by Lily Kay, have indicated really a great misuse of metaphors, of information and code as it's moved into biology. And the danger is that we simply move to a kind of view that Craig Venter said a few weeks ago on Science Friday, that we are simply DNA machines plus software. And what he would mean by the software is, of course, information and code. And it seems to me that nothing in your argument really implies or requires an essentialism of code and information within a kind of Thomistic Aristotelian perspective, which is much more epigenetic than these kind of preformationist metaphors we have. So I'd just like to know if you would comment on that and to how much you really are committed to an essentialism of code and information in dealing with this.
As distinct from a desirable essentialism of what?
Well, no, I'm not saying a desirable essential. I'm saying that in some ways, an Aristotelian view would be highly epigenetic in saying there isn't necessarily a preformation of anything that is going to simply lead us materially toward where the soul is in fact going to realize itself. And I think when we start using that there's going to be an essential code that's somehow realized, I think we do have a danger of some kind of essentialism that I don't think is required by your argument, is the point I want to make.
Well, I did take some care along the way to distinguish between the code or information and so on, simply as a topic of discussion which might or might not be actualized in some particular being. And on the other hand, the dynamic operation of a particular being, intelligible as the actualizing of information, code, messages, et cetera, et cetera. And I strongly think that a proper account of this, no doubt loosely used metaphor or analogies, I called it, a proper account will draw out the strong similarity between that and the sustainable, tenable parts of Aristotle's conception of form and matter, and the form as the act of the body.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, John. John O'Callaghan, Notre Dame. That really was, I joined with Phil, that really was a fine discussion of soul and body and form and matter and. So I was really thankful for that. This is a kind of point of clarification, again, about the issue of evolution. And it's really about evolution and the appearance of species, though it was against the background of what you said about Aquinas and continuous creation. I would have thought what you said earlier about primary and secondary causality, the transcendent creation, transcendent creative causality versus secondary natural causality, for Aquinas, that's sufficient to make the claim of continuous creation, acknowledging that the special creation of human souls doesn't work like that continuous creation. But then when you drew that to a point in the context of evolution, it seemed like you wanted to say that the appearance of new species would have helped Aquinas appreciate even more the continuous creation, because it seemed to me, and this is the clarification I'm asking for, that you wanted to say the appearance of new species, including non-human species, the appearance of new species, including non-human species, is something more like the direct creation of the soul than that operation of primary and secondary causality. So I got the impression that you were claiming in the context of evolution that we have special creation of species, including non-human species, and it's not an instance of the operation of secondary causality against the background of the primary causality of God. So that's a question of clarification. Do you mean to suggest special creation of all new species?
Well, the underlying issue is one that I think you didn't quite appear in your formulation of the issue, and that is whether the amount of information in the cosmos is increasing or not, or whether it was all there in potentia at the outset. I mean, and that's not simply a question about the distinction between primary and secondary causality, transcendent and secondary causality. It's got an element of fact, empirical fact in it, and I think and I didn't want to, you know, get in very deeply into the question of evolution. That wasn't my theme. But I think that making sense of the historic fact of evolution to the extent that it's a verified fact, and essentially a historical fact, making sense of that does require some sort of acceptance of the increase in information, and that need not be assumed to be simply a straight line, continual, unbroken stream of increase, but may have the character that we see with the emergence of distinct new species. So something distinct is added, so to say, from time to time. Which times? Well, the time of the emergence of this species, the emergence of life, as distinct from the billions of years where there was nothing in the way of life, as is the case in, no doubt, billions of other stars and planets. So I think there, you know, this is essentially an issue of empirical reflection to be conducted in the presence, so to speak, of these framing categories that you and I were using. Yeah.
Maria Federica, Ave Maria University. Thank you for your very fine lecture. I accept the idea of Aristotelian form as having primacy over matter, such that the organization of matter clearly depends on the presence of form. And we're used to thinking of God as directly creating the soul to account for the form of the human body. And in the case of animals, we're used to thinking of that form being passed on from one animal to the next generation. But my question is, where is that form? Let's say you have two rabbits. You have two gametes. They come together, but the form of rabbit is not in one gamete or in the other. And if you say that it's the physical condition of the gametes coming together that makes for the presence of the form, you've made matter have primacy over form. And so Leibniz's idea somehow that all forms are created at the beginning and have to be created directly by an act of God doesn't seem so bizarre in this context. I can't account for where the form... I was saying that Leibniz's idea that all forms were created by God at the beginning and are only waiting to be realized seems somewhat less bizarre, because I at least can't account for where the form of the new animal comes from if it's not in either gamete.
So you want to draw a distinction between the generation of one animal from another and the special case of human generation?
Yes, what is it? If the form can't really come from just one gamete, and the gametes coming together can't be what causes the form to be present, where does that form come from in the case of the new animal?
In the case of, say, dogs.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Well, we have an account of generation, which is is now pretty well established, and it shows at every point complex forms, very, very complex, as I indicated, coming together, that's to say, complex bodies informed by forms, by their form, coming together in the notable act of generation. But by no means peculiarly special act. I mean, metabolism itself. So there's the form in the food, the form of the food, the spinach or whatever it is, and then there's what it turns into, the blood. Are you puzzled in the same way about the emergence of form? I'm not seeing the problem.
I don't know whether I can make myself clear, but I'm just wondering, where does the form of the new baby rabbit come from?
Where does the blood that the spinach was an hour or two before, or the bile, or whatever it is, come from? Is that...
Yeah, that I guess that could be another question, a similar one. If the organization of matter depends on the prior, so to speak, metaphysically
no,
prior...
No, but the so to speak is doing all the work. It's not prior chronologically.
Metaphysically.
Yeah.
We have come to the end of our time, alas, but please join me in thanking John Finnis.